What you have here is a combination of lines and shading. So you've got something of a hybrid going. Something like a sort of, you're attempting to work from both worlds of sort of design. And what happened is that you have a three-dimensional going for you. It looks good. But you've got this line that you think is supporting the form structure, but it's not. It's really not supporting the form. It's diminishing the form. You're already pointing to the form with the fact that you've shaded here, with the fact that you've shaded. Let me get my teaching tool. The fact that you've shaded here, over here, over here, shadows here. These are all pointing to form. This cast shadow here, this cast shadow, you're already structuring the cube out. You're already designing the cube. So at this point, the line becomes obsolete. It doesn't, yeah, you're crossing over from line art toward form, but you have to understand that no matter how much you dress this image up, it's always going to have that issue. And it's always going to be that one image in your portfolio that has the combination of both sort of opposites on the spectrum design methods used, which is either you're rendering three-dimensionally or you're using lines to define the stamp of the form instead of the actual form of the form, the actual image, the photographic sort of projection of actual dimensions and shadows. So I recommend getting rid of the lines. I can't get rid of the lines in here, but I recommend getting rid of them. If you have them on a separate layer, just turn off that layer, and you'll see you don't really need them. They're more of a crutch that you're depending on. The other thing is the background versus the foreground. What you've got is something of a collage, and whenever you do that, you have to still follow the rules of composition that dictate the importance of the focal point and in comparison, the importance of the background. So when you're dealing with this light on light, so it's sort of both the earth and the female character are fighting for the focal point. You have to choose one, and the one that you choose that is the most important, you darken. Whenever you have an image, though, it's going to be weird if you choose the earth as the focal point and not the face, because whenever you have an image with a portrait in it, that automatically becomes the focal point, because the face is so detailed and it's such a cluster of detail and anatomy and personality and character that it automatically becomes the focal point. Is everybody with me? Okay, let me just look at this link here. All right, yes, the neck is a bit long. There is an issue with the proportions. But what I recommend is darkening the background, creating that space atmosphere, shrinking the size of the earth, throwing it off somewhere into the distance over here, and then, or behind her halfway, and having her be under some sort of separate kind of light source where you have collaged them too. It's like magazine cutouts. Have her own personal light shining on her to reveal her form. And that's pretty much all I recommend. I can't really paint it all for you, but I will try to, because it's really hard to lasso through all of this properly. So I'm going to try. Bear with me. Just want to give a proper critique. And you guys love the before and afters. I love the before and after, so I want to show you sort of what I'm talking about. All right. The neck is very, very long. When you don't have any shoulder to catch the neck, what you'll do accidentally is to extend the size of the neck. If you don't have anything to anchor the sort of the presence of the of the anatomy there. If you don't have somewhere where, if you're drawing an arm without a hand, if you're drawing a leg without a foot, you will draw that leg too long. So what I recommend is darkening the background. I'm going to get actually a multiply layer and a deep navy to darken this background with. I'm sort of going to create a gradient where things get darker towards the ground. And then you've got the glare. So darker, now we're starting to frame a little bit. And then what I'm going to do is sort of choose spots on the Earth's surface where it's really light, just to keep the Earth sort of looking spherical, to maintain its three-dimensional shape as well, because it is one big circle. Also, the Earth has something of a... Actually, I have to darken her as well. Select inverse. So we have to put her under some sort of light source as well. And I recommend the light that falls on her is similar to the light we see up here. So it's responding to that light source. So you really... Or you switch it up and you make her eyes and her nose and everything over here respond to a light that is coming from above her. So the light that's coming through this way. But either way, you have to sort of separate these two values, the value of the foreground versus the value of the background. You also have the option of making the background pastel or faded off. So something like this, where it's sort of faded off, and then you can heighten the contrast on her a little bit, because you're using white whites in this case. You're using super white whites, and those are a bit intense right now. They're really taking a lot away from the form. So there's a lot of ways to sort of separate this character from the background. Lots of ways. Let me jump into the anatomy real quick. The light spots are still the same light spots no matter where you go on the face. If there is a light source pointing at the face from above at an angle, so like this, the light spots all remain the same. Cheekbones, nose, eyelid. I don't know why so many of you forget the inner eyelid, the lower eyelid. Please don't forget it. Shadow of the upper eyelid. Let me turn off. Her eyebrow, she seems to be wearing eyeshadow that's stretching all across her face. And that's sort of taking away from the form, across her eyes, and that's sort of taking away from the form of her brows and her whole eye socket area. So don't confuse those two. Eyebrow bone and eyebrow and eyeshadow are all different units of the eye system. So if you combine them all to be represented by one shade, you're going to deplete from the realism. You're going to take away from it, and that's not a good thing. Especially in portraiture, you want to take every opportunity to sort of expand on the anatomy a little. So I'm just trying to find some structure here. I'm going to use the same shadows below the nose, below the nostril, I mean. And then for the lips, you've got this black on the lips. Lips, unless you've actually painted in that black, they're not going to be that black. So I recommend having one basic shade for the lips, and then finding the dark spot, the common skin tone color. Another issue that you sort of have here is you didn't choose a skin tone, your skin tone colors beforehand. What you did was you just freestyled, and that's not a good thing. Organize your palette, get your swatches down before you jump in. Really important. Throwing in some lashes. She was missing some. And that'll sort of carry the realism of her eye structure once again. Throw some shadow. Oops. Some shadow over here. Separate her brow bone from her eyes. She still has that sort of makeup, no eyebrow, Lady Gaga look, but we're still sort of working with the realism that we need. Her skin is a bit peachy now, so what I'm going to do is just brush. Actually, what I'll do is flatten image. I'll move the whole palette over toward the yellows just a touch so we can get some skin tones going. Actually, before I flatten the image. Okay. I'd move the palette over towards the yellows because those are the skin tones that we need to express on her face. Another thing is the profile view was a little bit suffering as well in anatomy. So what I would do is there are certain skeletal features that happen like on the skeletal level that are only observable if you see the face from the side. And so without using reference, you won't be able to guess how these specific bumps and combinations of skeleton and muscle work if you were to see them from the side. So always work with a reference if you feel lost, if you feel like you're not in control, if you're getting that overwhelming anxiety in the early stages of the painting, or you feel like you don't have enough control. Get a reference going, that'll really help you. I'm gonna, actually, I can't rotate. I'm going to push the eye forward just a little because we're seeing the eye from the side. And her features are very, very masculine, but her eyes are but her eyes are very small, and that's part of the reason why her features are masculine. And her brow bone is a bit strong as well. So I'm just going to increase the size of her eyes. Sort of soften her brow bone a little bit. Her chin, also shrink it down. And her jawline, lift it up. I know the earth is getting morphed as well, I'm sorry, but I'm pushing up her neckline. And now you've got a good base to work over. There are some details like the sphere around the earth, that delicate sphere that happens of blue. That's the atmospheric sort of ring. You might want to include that in there. That'll give it some level of realism as well. Just in the dark areas, that's where it's really visible. And then over here, it wouldn't be as visible because this is the lit spot. And then you see how she, it's even at this stage, after we balance it, it's very difficult to choose which one is the light source. So either you silhouette her completely and the background and the earth behind her act as the light source, or you darken the background completely, shrink the earth and push it away so that it becomes a secondary unit instead of a unit that's sharing her focal point with her. And that's sort of the main issue here. You were trying to do too much in one painting, and the focal point was being shared. So this was a composition issue mostly. So before, you see all those colors. The colors are from completely different areas of the color map. Pure white's used on her. Pure white's used on the background. Another way to create detail in a painting is high contrast. And so both were having high contrast. Black blacks and white whites. And after, I sort of just brought everything down to a pretty even tone. And even then, I will get another layer and try to find a way to unify the colors even further. And find one dominating color palette. So something like this will bring the tones down even more. And so what we really want to shade, we'll get an opportunity to shade it. So thinking about just the surface areas that really need the light. So the nose, the forehead, a little bit on the eyes, a little bit on the chin. And those are the only areas that would get that unifying light source. Let's say it's like a blue-white kind of light source. And then we would have that same blue color used over here. And this way we're unifying the palette and the same blue color used over here, and then we just throw one big spotlight to come down over her. And that way we're, and then of course you have to shrink the canvas down because she has to be centered in. This is a very graphic, not like, it's a very design sort of oriented painting where you have to think about the way you're creating this collage. So this is how I recommend doing it. A blue tint in the light source and the blue tint in the background will unify these two together. Rethink also her head plate design, because what you're telling me is that there's in the composition there's these big units and they have zero detail on them. But they're so big, they're as big as her head. And that's wrong. If it's not important, it gets shrunken down. And if it is important, if it is part of the storyline behind her design, what is she like? The Earth caretaker, Mother Earth. Maybe you want to bring in some bones. Maybe you want to bring in some leaves or weeds or something. I don't know, whatever the theme is, really. If the theme was Mother Earth, at that point you would be sort of investing some detail and some attention and some design sort of design thought into her headdress instead of having just a bunch of random shapes put together because they look good, or you think they look good. So either add some detail, add some structure, and do that. A small trick that I could give you is the layer modes on bevel, contour. Light source is coming from there. The light source color would be over here, and then shadow color would be over here. Chisel hard, normal. I would get like a brush and anything that I paint in here will be will have that lighting applied to it. Where is it? Is it not visible? So it's sort of a really cheap way, it's like a cheap way to, a quick way at least, to build a base sort of for the design. And you can get a good starting point for how you want to create the design on the hair, I mean on the headdress. And then you just go over here and edit the highlights that are being used and the shadows. These need to be a bit more visible. And you can play around with how the light is being reflected. So something like that. Sort of a quick cheat, at least as a base to start off the sort of chiseled look for the convert to smart object for the headdress. And then you can paint over it to add some detail. And that's sort of a quick way to do it. But again, unify your color palette, please. Don't just throw a bunch of colors together. Just looking at the before and after here, you can see the issues that were happening before. Really busy, really hurtful on the eyes. Really difficult. Really difficult to look at the image and not get like a headache because there's too much contrast, too much saturation, too much detail, too much fighting. It's like a battlefield for who, last man standing for the focal point. And after we balanced it. And if it does seem a little low contrast to you, up the contrast only where you need it. So on the forehead, on the tip of the nose, over here on the earth, you know, whatever, wherever you want to go with it. So I'll flatten this and send it to you. This image here, small and angry. Okay, I'm going to jump into Liquify because I really want to show you. This is a very, basically what you're drawing right now is, this is the extent of this expression. Even if, and however you flower it, however you've flowered it and given it detail, you're still, no, it wasn't like that, it was like this. You're still using the core, basic expression, which is, I'm sad but angry. There is a more detailed and more expressive and more thorough way to sort of express her anger. First of all, never use upside down happy face to make a sad face. Sadness can be created by this. This could be sadness. This could be sadness. See how much sadness is in this one? Like, he's half smiling, but not really. Oh yeah, I'll try the two-layer before and after again. I'm sorry about that. And now when you want to add eyebrows, this is contentedness. And this is sort of, am I really happy right now? And this is angry, but sort of steady, a steady anger. And this is like an extended anger. And these are lines. These are symbols. If you ever read Scott McCloud, he really talks about how the basic expression is, it becomes universal and it becomes very boring very fast. So you have to dress it up a little. So that's what you're doing here. There are ways to make her look angry and sort of having trouble being taken seriously because she's small with a little bit less stated upside down C mouth. Not even sure how to say that. With a little less stated mouth expression. So you can make her expression a little more subtle. And it would still work the same way. She would look less like a cartoon. It would be very easy to take her seriously as a drawing. There is also, knowing how the eye functions, I mean, you still need anatomy. Even at this point, this is the perfect example of how cartoonists need anatomy. Because understanding that the eye can squint is a big part of function. And maybe you can make her eye squint a little bit. And that would really extend her expression even further. And pushing her eyebrows up is giving another kind of expression. If you want to make her angry, don't push her eyebrows up like this, because now she looks like she's in pain. So you want to be able to just show a pure anger with the eyebrows. She is angry. She is angry. She is pissed off. But her mouth is sort of less like that. I'm just trying to balance the nose in. I'm also going to shrink the eyes just a little bit. I know it's a cartoon. You can get away with it. But I feel like you're entering Disneyland and it's sort of not really Disney. The Disney eyes are way too big that they take up the whole face and the whole expression. No matter how much the eyebrows are, or what the eyebrows are doing, the whole expression becomes geared towards the face. I'm also going to shrink her lips just a little bit because the triangle is being challenged at this point. Also, you don't really need the side views of the eye. So, I mean, of the side lines of the lip. So let me show you before what was happening with her face. It was very caricature-y and very cartoony. Like, it was almost comical. It's almost funny. You know, it's like an anime emotion expression. Or an emoji. Do you guys see that? Is everybody with me? Before, after. This is a more realistic, I didn't change your colors. The lines are still there. It's a better way to express the expression. It's a better way to produce a more mature and sort of more thorough, realistically geared rendition of this expression that is happening in the real world, but represented by a stamp, the stamp of lines. Yes, the breasts are too big, but I guess sometimes breasts are just very important for the design, especially if you're a male artist. I've never seen female artists paints big breasts. It's just always the male artist that sort of overstated. Maybe this is a female artist, I don't know. Also, when you place in the boobs are, you need to get rid of some lines. Here's a tiny little lesson on boobs, guys. Please listen to me. In your mind, the symbol of boob is this. Okay? It's these eyeballs. Alright, this is how you pigs see boobs, alright? You don't have to be a man to remember boobs are like this, but if you're an artist, can you please start imagining boobs as maybe like this? Or a little bit more realistically, maybe boobs that are different sizes. Start seeing different boobs instead of this typical stamp, because this stamp, whether you like it or not, is going to leak through and enter into your drawing. and you won't know that it's doing it, because this stamp is the immediate image drawn out of your visual library. So you accidentally start drawing the circle beside the circle and don't even know you're doing it. Also, in art, what we do is we combine shapes to make one big shape. So if this is the chest, this is the boob circle. Once you want to combine them and you're done drawing your shapes, erase some of the lines away, because they're the lines you don't need them anymore. There are lines you don't need because you want to combine the two shapes together. All right? So you erase the lines that help iterate the fact that these boobs, these circles, and this back square are united now. They're one piece. So with the lines you've overused here for the top of the breast, you might want to take away some of them, because what they're doing is they're creating symbols and they're looking less realistic. All right, just the tops, just to show that these boobs are somehow connected to this face. Now, this body, now they look a lot less large, a lot less overstated. So what I was talking about earlier was these little lip lines. You don't really need them that much. What you can do to extend the expression even more is give her a little ripple on the side of her face. Well, I'm going to sneak. Be right back. Sorry. So yeah, maybe you want to add in one of those little lines to show that her expression is sort of ticked off and angry. Another thing is her leg. Her whole body is back there. Let me create some maps. Let's say that there is this horizon line right here. Horizon line isn't just the horizon line of the distance. Horizon line is every line sitting on the surface of the Earth. It's called the horizon line. Let's say there's a line going over here, and then there's a horizon line here, and there's a line here. Her whole body is back there, but her leg is all the way up here. How did that happen with her body being back there? Her leg must have stretched, because if we were to see her from the side, this is line number one. This is line number two, and this is her leg. So this is what happened, all right? If you want to do foreshortening, you're going to have to push the torso forward so that it's sitting between both lines. And that, so that she can seem like she's actually fitting in between these two lines of perspective. Excuse me. I'm getting sick. I don't know why. The quick fix is to shrink this leg, of course. But if you do want to create foreshortening, that's something you do in the gesture line phase. So again, just because you want to be a cartoonist and you don't want to deal with the realism in anatomy doesn't mean you escape it entirely. You're not home free yet. You still have to deal with most of the crap that you've got to deal with if you're an artist going for perfect anatomy. You still have to deal with that world, because gestures are still in it. You're still going to create humanoids. You're still creating something you want us to believe is real. So if you think you can escape, you can't. We'll catch you. We'll torture you. We will, with the critiques anyways. So please invest some time in your gesture drawings if you do want to do dynamic poses, like the foreshortening. Invest some time in some gesture drawings. It's not going to kill you, and you're not going to die. They're really helpful. They'll push your designs a little further, and you'll thank yourself. I'm going to shrink the canvas down a little bit. Save. All right. How big is this file? Okay. So before, do you see the expression? After. The expression is a lot easier to accept now. Okay. So before, after. Before, after. Before. After. Especially if you want to go into animation. Anatomy is just one huge part of animation, by the way. You're not going to escape it. Rufa, I'll try to do a boob tutorial soon. I did one before, but I didn't publish it because I didn't want kids to see it. It was actually a really dumb reason, and yeah, I did a whole tutorial on butts and boobs I completely deleted. Well, I'll do it again for you guys. Okay? So that's that. Hope that helped you. I'll send it back to you. If I have any of your images and I haven't sent them back to you, message me on Facebook, please. The Facebook page is Istebrak, just my name. And I'll send these back to you guys. Okay, I'm gonna look at Jacob's next. Save as desktop. No, Rufo was talking about boobies. Okay, so if this is a study, then I would need the reference that you worked with. Because I don't really, like, unless I'm critiquing it as separate from the study, which I guess I will. The first thing that comes to me is symmetry. Her body's directed towards the camera, so it's an opportunity for us to express some real symmetry happening and observe the symmetry in the reference. Her shoulders aren't symmetrical. Maybe that issue arose when you were dealing with the secondary light source. Sometimes secondary light source dealing with it can really affect your anatomy. You just don't notice the mistakes happening. The foot seems a bit long. I'm just gonna push it forward just a little. Other than that, I would definitely need to see the reference to see if you had any major observation issues. For the face, the nose is a little short and cut off too soon. And there is no flesh expressed from the side. Like I said before, there are things that you can only see if you were to see the face from the side. And you would need a reference to sort of know how these little tiny nuances happen. So one of these things is the flesh dips, the true valleys that happen between the features of the face and how they're expressed when we see them from the side. So before, after, tiny little corrections that I recommend you make because they're just sort of, see where the shoulder was? It's like one shoulder was thinner and didn't have bone or something. And then now we've fixed it. Also, be careful of using a tiny brush to express the highlighted hairs on the side because you are pointing all the detail. All the eyes are going here. Just ask yourself, where do you guys find yourselves looking? You just find yourselves looking here because this is where the focus is and everything else is blurred compared to this. You don't want to do that. Just instead of doing that, get a large brush. And throw in that texture just with some strokes like that. Keep everything rough. Instead of using such tiny, tiny little brush. Because you want to save those and preserve that brush for detail that is on the face and stuff. Okay? So be careful with using a small brush. That's really all that I wanted to do for this one. Before, without the circle, after. I'm losing my voice. My voice is going. It's gone. This one, I'm so sorry. This one is about a blending issue. What I have here is the, you're painting it as if each feature of the face is separate and it's not part of the same singular unit. The way to unify features as if they're attached to the same face is with light source. Make sure the lighting is in check. Sometimes be careful also with makeup. Can really give you trouble. You painted the eyebrows as if they're a separate unit. You need to blend them together. You need to start blending these features together. And guys, I'm holding all of you to my bosom. I have so many videos on how to draw eyes, nose, and lips. I don't get it when I see one of my followers draw a nostril by outlining it. It's like the number one rule that I say not to do. And if you're working with a reference, you read the reference wrong. because you're doing this for the nostril, and then you're just shading around it and trying to make it look pretty. This is wrong. A nostril is shadow, a nose meaning. This is shadow and nostrils. That's it. That's all a nose really, really is, and I show you how to do it. A little bit of lighting happens here and there, but now she's going to have a nose on the side of her face, but I'm sorry. That's all a nose really, really is, guys. It's this. That's it. Bob and Steve, yes, thank you. So please don't forget to take a look at those videos. I mean, I've spent so much of my energy making those videos for you, and they will help you read noses from references better. If you don't want to paint like me, don't. I'm not saying paint exactly the same nose I paint. All I'm saying is please invest some time in researching how to read your references better, and I have videos teaching you guys how to read your references better. You guys are drawing noses by outlining them. This is wrong. This is absolutely wrong, because right now you're drawing the symbol of a nose. You're still depending on the line. And whenever I see that, I get mad because I don't want you guys to mix line art with form and blending and form structure. Give the eyebrow a little bit of fuzz. Please don't draw Scow's brow. Scow's brow is it's an eyebrow that's drawn in. It actually looks like it's drawn in. Unify the features together a little bit by blending them together, letting each little hair cast a shadow. I made the eyebrows a little bit purple because her eyebrow is purple and blue are the dominant colors here, so I want to continue that. I'm going to erase this stuff you have on the eyebrow, on the nose. I'm going to erase the side of the nostril. I'm going to cast a shadow of the nostril, of the nose down. Then I'm going to darken the nostril because it's part of the dark spots. Do you see what happened to the nose? It still reads. It's still looking okay. It's still working. It's not an outline. It's not a symbol of a nose. It's a real nose. It's not... I just don't want you guys to draw bad drawings accidentally. If you're capable of it, and you have the resources available, and you guys do. You guys live in the age of the internet. You guys have resources up the butt. And I don't want to, if I see an issue like that, I don't want to let it go. I want every painting, whoever sent me this, I want every painting from now on. I don't want you to ever paint eyebrows like a Sharpie again, and I don't want you ever to paint nostrils by outlining them. This is the moment where you stop. This is the moment in your life where you stop doing this, and you started thinking three-dimensionally. She looks younger because I took away the little cheek line. Once you put that back in, she'll look older because those are the things, one of the first signifiers of age, one of the first things that age. That's why she looked a little younger. You can keep those in if you'd like. I'm going to bring down the skin tone. I'm going to actually bring in a purple. You know, in color modes, bring in that pretty purple we had. And sort of cool down her skin tone, because we had orange versus purple, and you need to choose one that was dominating. My bad, that was bad color to choose. Cool down her skin tone a little. Okay. I'm gonna jump into liquify. The Cupid's bow of lips happens at the tip of the lips. It doesn't extend. So if there is a dip in the lips, it happens here only. Everything else builds up to it. So this is where we would have the lips bend in, and this is where we'd have the Cupid's bow happen. A little overstated because of the zoom in. If she is smiling, you don't have to do this for her to smile, which is where you had it before. It was a bit too extended. If you want to have a subtle smile, and a little more tasteful and classy sort of expression instead of something too stated and too expressive like we did, like we saw earlier with the cartoon drawing. Do it subtly. I'm going to push the nose back in towards the face. I'm going to shrink the liquify brush all the way down and pull out some lashes. I'll do that with the smudge tool. So before, after. I'm was a little masculine as well. The fact that it pushed down a little bit. So I'm just going to sharpen her chin just a little. It's not an over sharpening. Just a little. Making it look a little smoother. And I don't know really what reference you used and how you read the reference. I'm not really sure. I'm going to choose a light source that's a little purpley whitish for the areas that are being touched by the light. Tip of the nose and the chin. So we keep the palette going back towards this graphic that you have here. Color. I'm not really sure. I want to tell you to sort of gray out her whole face so that everything stays cool and goes back to this. I'm not really sure because we've got oranges happening, and I don't know if you want to keep the oranges and make her face look a little more pink and then make the flowers have less purple in them. But you've got the purple going, and the purples and the oranges are not coming from the same place on the color palette, and I've got tutorials on that if you don't know what that means. Okay, so actually what I will do for the sake of the... So I'm just going to change the color of her eyeshadow to match. I'm going to use the same pink on her lips as the pink. Now the colors are sort of matching each other better. And I'm going to use the same pink on her lips as in the flower and then on her cheeks as well. That way we're unifying them. Actually, I'll change it to the purple of that flower, not the, because it's like starting to look green compared to the yellow. And that way the colors are matching a little bit. And now that we look at it, the shoulder seems to be a little bit displaced. I would want to see the shoulder somewhere over here. Why is it? Why is it giving me a little? I don't know, man. Dang it all. Motherfucker. Give me a minute, guys. Why? Why is it giving me this fucking outline? Ah! It's okay. It's okay. It's all good. Everything's gonna be okay. I'm just gonna paint over it. Ah! Okay, so do you guys see what I'm doing? I sort of balanced the colors just a little bit. I'll show you where they were before. Before you start painting, choose the colors you want to use. And then paint over them. What you had before, the flowers had to be way darker. You had a pure white happening on the flowers. And I don't want to touch those because it seemed like you got them from somewhere. And after, I sort of balanced the skin tone to match hers. And the colors on her to match her flowers. To match. I don't even know what I'm saying. I'm so sorry. I'm really sick. Do you guys see how they started to get balanced a little bit? The shoulder is a bit orange still. Oops. Might want to throw in some detail for the hair. I forgot the two layer. I'm sorry. I'm very sorry. All right. Before, after. So it's a matter of unifying the colors that you're using in your little frame of canvas here. Unifying the colors together so they match each other. All right. And then finally this one. This is a proportion issue right here that's happening. And what I would need to see is just everything sitting on the same symmetry line. So the eye before was sitting on a different symmetry line. The two nostrils here are sitting on different symmetry lines. The lip corners are sitting on different symmetry lines. So this, if I was diagnosing you as the artist right now, where you are in your art journey, is you need to invest some time in proportion and understanding and reading proportions that happen, that are happening, proportions that happening, and reading proportions that happening in your references. It's very, very important to read the proportions. So this is it now, before. Do you see where the eyes were? After. Before. After. Before. After. Her eyes are a little bit closer together, so from the reference, her eyes were a little bit further apart, which is why she looks so cute. You can do that. Just make sure you're doing it proportionately. If her head was a bit more square, if her cheeks were a bit bigger, okay to do it. Make sure you're doing it in a way where you're still sitting on the horizontal lines that happening. Oh my god, I cracked myself up. So, I'll do the before and after now. Before. After. Okay, so do you see the proportion? I was a bit, I was a bit off. I'm sorry about laughing. I'm not laughing at your image. I'm laughing at myself. Anyways, bye guys, and thanks again for your support. Bye-bye.